morning, church. I like that. It's great to spend another week with you as we take an opportunity to lift the name of Jesus high above the noise, above the confusion of this world, above the sin of this world, so that people can clearly see who is the answer to what's happening in this world and the answer to their own personal sin, to give them eternal life. Would you stand and join us on this song? I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. Our weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah, everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah, I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you lost your hold on me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, start this.
Sing a little louder.
Men.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies. Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
I'm gonna sing.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah. Of Jesus, our King. Make known the power of His grace, the beauty of His peace. Remember how His mercy reached as we cried out to Him. He lifted us to solid ground, to freedom from our sin. Of Jesus, our Lord. His power in us is greater than this world. To share the reason for our hope, to serve with love and grace, that all who see Him shine through us might bring the Father praise. Soul and tell all He's done till the earth and heavens are filled with His glory. Lift high the name of Jesus our life. No other name on earth can save, can raise the soul to life. He opens up our eyes to see the harvest He has grown. We labor in His field of grace as He leads sinners home. Oh, sing my soul.
Sing it again, sing
my soul, and tell all He's done, till the earth and heavens are filled with His glory.
Till the earth and heavens.
Till the earth and heavens are filled with His glory.
One more time.
Till the earth and heavens are filled with His glory.
Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning. My name is Jason. I am one of the associate pastors here at Crosspointe. We're very glad that you are here today. And if you are new to us, we have a QR code on a piece of paper in the pew around you that you can scan. And if you'd be willing to let us know a little bit about yourself, ways that our church can be praying for you, or any information you might like, that would be great. If you're watching online, you can do that as well. There may be a QR code on the screen that you're seeing, or there will be information in the chat on the online service. So please let us know who you are, what you need, and how we can answer any of those questions. There are a few different things in your service program, but I want you to know for sure a number of things. And first, this week starts the Alpha course. Alpha this year is going to be held on Zoom as it was last year, and we've already told you that this is a fantastic opportunity for people to explore the claims of Jesus. And we encourage people to ask and process their questions about faith openly in a conversational environment. So Alpha is a formative experience that helps people encounter Jesus. And while it can also be a reinvigorating experience for those who are of the Christian faithful, it's primarily designed for individuals newer to Christianity, as well as people who are considering the faith and those who have never heard about Jesus. So you may know someone in your own life like that. And we were all like that at one time. Romans 10:14 tells us, how are they to believe in Him of whom they have never heard? So we know you could bring someone to church and they could hear about Jesus, but we also know
excuse me, that not everyone is at a point where they're opening to visiting a church, but they may be open to a more informal setting like that of Alpha. And that's why we've made invitations available to you. They're on the tables as you leave that you can pass to someone who may be interested in something like that. But we would love to have you or someone you know attend Alpha. You can find more information, yourc3.org/alpha, and that starts January 25th. Also, this coming Friday is our Buck Dinner. There are still tickets. And so you can see Mr. Brewer, he will be at the kiosk just to the right. If you're wondering what that is, we eat venison, we hear a speaker, and we enjoy ourselves. And he can tell you a little bit more about that if you want more questions. You may have noticed that we're taking pictures in the gathering space this morning. You can get a donut, eat the donut, wipe your face off, and then you can get your picture taken. The reason we're doing this is because we're updating our online directory. And we want your nice smiling faces as they are today in that directory. And then finally, we are still looking for people to sign up to read the Bible. In February, from February 13th through 20th, we are going to try as a church to read the entire Bible out loud here. Not everyone all the time. I know there's a little bit of confusion, but what we're looking for you to do is to come and be a part of the team. Pick a 20-minute, 30-minute, I think it's 20-minute session where you come in and you read wherever we have left off. If the previous person made it through to Matthew 22, verse 17, you're going to pick it up in Matthew 22, verse 18, and you're going to read for the next 20 minutes until that next person can come in. You might say, I can't read out loud for 20 minutes. Bring your family. Split it up. Find a friend and say, will you read while I'm reading? Can we go back and forth? There are no rules, and you don't tell that to people because then they do whatever they want. There are rules, all right? But we want this to be something that is a reminder for our church and for our people that this is what Crosspointe is centered on. We're centered on Scripture. So we're going to endeavor to read the Bible from Genesis 1 all the way to the end of Revelation on those days, February 13th through 19th. You can sign up and choose a time at yourc3.org/Bible. Will you pray with me? Father, we are so grateful for this morning. Grateful that we can gather here. I'm thankful that you brought those who are here safely. Whenever it snows on a Sunday morning and it feels like the first time, there's always nervousness. And Lord, you have guided us here in safety, and we're grateful for that. I pray that as this service unfolds, as we continue to worship together through singing, through the hearing of your word, Lord, that our hearts will be open to whatever it is that you have for us today. And in whatever way we may need to change. God, we want to honor you in everything that we do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand and join us on the chorus.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to
King of all days.
King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became.
Here I am to worship.
Together lovely,
to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin. Song for the longest time. Talking about the love of Jesus. Well, we're going to sing a bit of an older song now. Matter of fact, it was 10 years old by the time Third German American Baptist Church was founded. So I guess you could say that it was a contemporary song for them. One that I hope that its message lives on to today. That we come here every week, yes, not only to see friends and to enjoy each other and enjoy the singing, but to learn about Jesus, to learn more and more about him so that we can become more and more like him and we can more and more love him. Would you join us on this song? Jesus, would I know more of his grace to others show, more of his saving fullness see, more of his love who died for me, for me. Jesus in his word, holding communion with my Lord, hearing his voice in every line, making each faithful saying mine. More of his saving fullness, more of his love who died for me. More about Jesus on his throne, riches in glory.
Today, we are going to be in John chapter 1. We're going through verse 9. My voice is a little off today. My children started basketball yesterday, and I coach a kindergarten through second grade girls team. Okay? Coach is a strange word. It's more like herding cats, right? And then I coach a fifth and sixth grade boys team. And so I made an effort and told myself, I can't yell too much because I have an important part of my job the next day, and that lasted about a half. I don't scream. Some of you don't know me real well. I don't scream like at kids, like, you're terrible, and things like that. I just yell to be loud so that they hear you because they have other people yelling at them, and I need to be the loudest, or that's how I feel. And so it's a little weird this morning, so I just want to let you know that ahead of time. As we get into John, and we have been moving into this, we're talking about what John says about Jesus and the different metaphors and kind of how he sets it up. And so last week, Pastor Matt talked a little bit about Jesus is the Word. Today, we're going to talk about Jesus as well, but something different. So I want to invite you to stand if you're able, and we're going to read, starting with verse 1 all the way to verse 9, just so that we have a feel for how it all goes together. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. Father, will you add a blessing to the reading of this word? I pray that we will be attentive to what your Spirit would have us do with this today. I pray that it will meet us where we are. Lord, help us to set aside the worries and the thoughts of the day and instead to focus in on what you have for us this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, hopefully you're starting to notice that there's a different feel to John. If you've ever read Matthew, if you've ever read Mark, if you've ever read Luke, you know that those begin kind of with a birth narrative. They tell us a little bit about how Jesus came into the world. But we get to John, and John doesn't do that. There's this different feel. We have this prologue, we call it, where John lays out a number of important themes that he's going to get to again later in the gospel. Last week, Pastor Matt talked about Jesus being the Word, and that is a very important theme and one that will come up again and again. This week, we're looking at this idea of Jesus as the light. Now, when we get to John 8, all right, Jesus is going to declare himself to be the light of the world. So there are some things that I will not say today. Some of you who've maybe thought or heard about this concept of Jesus as the light before, you're wondering, well, why isn't he saying this? Why isn't he saying that? Hold on. We will get there. All right, we've got the whole gospel to go through. So this morning, all I really want to do is look specifically at these verses, these six verses from verse 4 through 9 to see what John the writer tells us about Jesus being the light. He begins in verse 4 by telling us that in him, in Jesus, was life, and the life was the light of men. Now, if you were with us last week, Pastor Matt walked us through the creative language that John uses at the beginning. All right, John, as he's unfolding and unpacking his gospel, uses language that sounds very similar to Genesis. It says, in the beginning was the Word. And if we go to Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, right? And so Jesus, or John, is kind of setting us up for us to see that there was this creation narrative, the beginning of the world, and this is an important event as well, right? This is an essential event in our understanding of the world, the coming of Christ, right? And you know also, if you know a little bit about Genesis, you know the first words that we read that God speaks is, let there be what? Light. Good. Some of you are like, yes, I got that one. If that was Jeopardy, you got that question, right? I always got excited and still do when it's like Teen Jeopardy. I'm like, these are questions I can handle. All right, bring them on. All right, so yes, let there be light. And here we have John, and John is saying Jesus was the light. And so John is drawing and connecting and pulling that thread that the Bible starts in Genesis and pulling it through here to Jesus so that we see those connections. And John's writers would have readers would have understood this, and they also would have understood kind of what we grasp, that concept of the wrestling, of the fight between light and darkness is something that really comes to define us as people. You know, every culture has stories. And in almost every culture, those stories involve a struggle between light and darkness. Some of the great stories of our time, whether it be Star Wars, whether it be The Lord of the Rings, whether it be things like this, have within them that conflict between light and darkness. So as John's readers are reading this, and as we are reading this as well, we hear about the struggle, and we're like, yes, this is real. This is how it is. This is true. And so we understand that, and biblical writers always working towards John would use the term of darkness to talk about death or ignorance or sin and separation from God. And so John knows this. And John probably, as he's writing, is thinking of passages in the Old Testament. We really think that he had in mind here Isaiah 9. In Isaiah 9, which is considered a passage that talked about the one to come. It's an Old Testament passage from the prophet Isaiah where he said some things about the one who would come, the promised one that would come one day. In that passage, it's part of that whole section where we have that Christmas passage we read a lot where it's, for unto us a child is born and a son is given. But if you go to the beginning of Isaiah 9, Isaiah says this, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them a light has shone. John is thinking of this. John knows about this, and his readers know what he's getting at here, that this is the one we've been waiting for. The light has come. All right, but John does more than just introduce us to a Savior who's going to lead us into the light. John tells us that our Savior, he tells us that Jesus is the light. And this has profound implications for us as we'll work through this gospel. Jesus doesn't come simply to point us in the right direction. Jesus doesn't come to offer teachings that will make your life better. Jesus doesn't come to present an idea of life. Jesus comes and says, I am that. All right, I'm not pointing you in a direction. I'm pointing you to myself. I'm bringing you in. He saves from the darkness and brings us to the light, brings us to himself. Sometimes people will say things like, I really like Jesus' teachings. I like those things that he says about treating others nicely and putting others before yourself and that Good Samaritan path. Those are good stuff. And yes, I mean, I'm not here to tell you we don't like Jesus' teachings. We do. But if you separate the teachings of Jesus from the person of Jesus, you don't have anything. Or you have a philosopher, you have a teacher, but you don't have who Jesus claims to be and who John outlines that he would be. And so right away here at the beginning, Jesus, or John rather, confronts that, because Jesus' teachings are incredibly important, but they're meaningless when they're separated from who he is. Jesus is the light. He's not pointing us to the light or helping us go in the direction of the light. He is the light. Now, what does that mean for us? All right, what does it mean that Jesus is the light? And again, John is going to unpack this as he goes through the gospel, but there are three things that I want to highlight out of this passage this morning that I think can be helpful for us today. All right, and the first is this, that Jesus overcomes the darkness. In verse 5, John tells us that the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. If John had an editor during this time, if John had an agent, a literary agent, they would say, John, you can't put this in here. You are spoiling the whole thing. All right, it's as though John went and saw a movie, right, and immediately got on Twitter and said, listen, Bruce Willis was always alive, and just ruins it for everyone. Right? Some sort of huge spoiler. Because he says, listen, the darkness comes against it. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness hasn't overcome it. If you start to read through the gospel, once we start to do that, we don't know that. All right? It looks tenuous at times. Now, Jesus demonstrates great strength, great power. He heals. He does miracles. He's walking on water. He's changing water into wine. He's doing all of these things. But there's always this undercurrent of resistance. There's always this undercurrent of someone against him. There's people who want him dead. And so we don't know where this is heading, except that John tells us right off the bat, listen, the light will not be overcome. Just want you to know that. All right, it's likely that he was writing to people who knew that already. All right, but he's telling us right off the bat, the darkness does not win. And he says something that's, it's almost something that we skip by. The light shines in the darkness. And we nod, shines, yes. But that word shines is so important, because this is the first time in John's gospel where he uses present tense. You know, before, it's in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, right? And all of these things in past tense. John is narrating what happened. But when he gets to this idea of darkness, he says Jesus shines in the darkness. And he doesn't say that Jesus shone in the darkness. He doesn't talk about that Jesus went into the darkness, shined his light, and is now no longer there. John is laying out what is an essential truth for Christians, that Jesus shines in the darkness. He shone in the darkness. He was shining in the darkness during John's time, and he shines in the darkness during our time as well. And as a Christian, as a believer, this should be incredibly encouraging to us. You know, I remember as a kid, I wanted to be like my cousin, right? My cousin was just a couple years older than me. I wanted to be able to do what he would do. And if he could do it, I could do it, right? If he did it, I would try. If he would jump off that diving board, then I felt like I could jump off that diving board. If he climbed that tree, then I felt like I could climb that tree. And sometimes people treat Jesus that way. Well, if Jesus did it, then I bet I could do it too. All right, like Jesus has blazed a path for us. Now, some of that is true. Jesus has blazed a path to heaven for us. But it's not like he did that and then abandoned the path. It's not like he's gone and he's like, figure it out. I made it. You can too. Jesus shone in the darkness, and he shines in the darkness. All right? We don't want to think that we can handle the darkness of life only because Jesus has been there and has conquered it. There's truth to that, but it's not the entire truth. John's language implies that we are not alone in this. He shines today. And then don't forget the second part of that verse, that the darkness has not overcome it. And right here at the very beginning, he reminds us, John is saying, listen, listen, there's darkness. We know that. He uses that word darkness twice. You feel darkness in your life. You see that. All right, we feel darkness sometimes physically as our bodies no longer respond in the way that we expected them to at one point. I turned 42 this year. I know some of you are like, that's a young whippersnapper, and I need those comments. All right? But I sprained my ankle playing basketball with my son in like October. I don't know. It still hurts. It still hurts. You know, he might sprain his ankle tomorrow and be like, I'll be fine by Thursday, right? That's just wrong. All right? Some of you sense the darkness that comes physically as your body no longer responds in the way that it once did. Some of us have this emotional darkness within us because you're dealing with difficult things, things that 20 years ago you didn't think you'd be dealing with now. The sickness of a loved one, the people who can't care for themselves who once did. And you're dealing with that, and you're in the middle of that right now. Sometimes there's this spiritual darkness where we do not feel close to the Lord. Because of whatever's going in our life, we do not feel close to the Lord. And when I say darkness, probably something comes into everyone's mind about what that is. Your parent passed away. You know, the test that you got back wasn't what you expected. Your child isn't flourishing like you hoped that they would at this point. The relationship that you're in is not working the way it once did or the way that you would hope that it would. Whatever it might be, there is this darkness. And John is reminding us, yes, but you are not alone. Jesus is there in that darkness. He's shining in that darkness. Earlier we sang a hymn, More About Jesus. And Ed explained to us that it's a contemporary song from the time our church was founded. This is our 125th year. And so we have behind here all of the different facets or the different lives, in a sense, of our church. And when we began as Third German American Baptist Church, we sang that hymn, More About Jesus. It was written by a lady named Eliza Hewitt. And she wrote that song, or was born, rather, in 1851. She became a teacher as a young woman, but because of an accident with a student where they threw a piece of slate at her, she was essentially bedridden for the next several years. She was in a sense of physical darkness. Maybe it poured over into emotional darkness. I don't know. But the way in which she dealt with it was to write. And she wrote poems. Poems that became hymns like the one that we sang today. She wrote a number of other poems as well. And one of them says, there is sunshine in my soul today. How can she write about things like this in the darkest days of her life? How can she, as she's laying on a bed where some of us would just be playing over and over again in our mind that whole situation that brought us here, and why, Lord, and I feel abandoned, and why am I here? Yet, she knew that in that darkness that she was in, Jesus shines. He is there. And he overcomes the darkness. But he does more than just that. We keep reading and we see that Jesus calls us out of the darkness. In verse 6, John takes us on a brief rabbit trail that we will revisit, or he'll revisit in a couple passages, and we'll get there later. But he starts to introduce us to John the Baptist. Now, this can be confusing because we know that the gospel's written by John, and then he starts talking about someone named John, different John. Okay? Took me a few times reading it. The first time when I was going through John, I was very confused. Like, John is now talking about himself in third person. I guess we're doing that today. All right, but he talks about and says, starting in verse 6, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. This is who we call John the Baptist. We call him that because he baptized people. All right, John the Baptist, he came as a witness to bear witness about the light that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. Now, as a child, when I was kind of growing up in church, that's my background, whenever the story came up of John the Baptist, whenever they broke out the flannel graph or the teacher was going to describe it, I got so excited because he's an engaging character. We read in other Gospels that he wore the hair of animals. He ate locusts and honey, and I always thought that was so cool to eat locusts. I remember one time I was with someone, and they're like, we can eat locusts here. And I said, I don't like the story that much. I'm not going to do that, all right? I know people do that in parts of the world, but I don't feel the need, all right? But it was engaging. He's this engaging personality. And during that time, people would come to hear him. People would come to see them, all right? And he becomes an important character, an important person in the account of Jesus in his early ministry. But as John is writing, John, the author, wants us to understand John the Baptist's purpose. His purpose was to bear witness to point to testify about Jesus. John the Baptist's purpose and the purpose of John's gospel is to point others to the light. Some people read this and they read into it a little bit and feel like there's a possibility that when John was writing, there were still people who revered John the Baptist so much that they almost put him on the same pedestal, the same place as Jesus. They felt like they were followers of John the Baptist, and then when Jesus came along, they just kind of stuck to following John the Baptist. And so it may be here that John, the writer of the gospel, is saying, listen, was John the Baptist important? Yes, but this is what he did. Because three different times, John the author says, he bore witness about the light. He wasn't the light. He was pointing others towards Jesus. John the Baptist called people away from the darkness. He told them to repent. But as soon as Jesus steps onto the scene, John the Baptist says, here he is. Here he is. Last night, my wife and I, we went to see a comedian. We went with some friends. And it was a good comedian. Just want you all to know that. But before they send out the guy you came to see or whoever, they send someone else out just to kind of prime the crowd, right? And he was good. He was good. You know, I looked him up later, and he was nice. He was funny. But no, once the guy came out, once the person we were there to hear came out, this guy just pointed and walked off the stage. Because had he stayed there and wanted, like, we're together, you know, I'm here, people would be like, move. We did not pay. We don't even know who you are today. Move off the floor, all right? John the Baptist, in a similar way, is like, listen, I've been priming the pump here. I've been getting you ready. Behold the light. I'm bearing witness to the light. Let me point to you who will call you out of darkness. John bears witness about the light, all right? He calls people to repent. He calls them away from their sin. But when Jesus steps on the stage, John is ready to move aside. You know, I think for us that this is helpful. I think this picture of John pointing to Jesus as Jesus calls people out of darkness is helpful because we struggle in our time about how to deal with people who do not share our faith. You know, we become paralyzed a lot of times because we try and consider how do we share our faith with other people. It's easy when our lifestyles kind of match, right? It's easy when we're very similar to someone. It's easy when there's another family next door, you know, and they go somewhere on Sunday too, and hey, let's talk about what we believe in, and let's challenge each other in our faith. That's kind of easy. But when someone totally different shows up, when someone totally different moves in on the street, they clearly don't share your values. They put up all their political signs. You're like, those are not my signs. And you do not agree on things. How do we begin to interact with them in a way that helps them to see the light? Oftentimes, and I think it's well-meaning possibly, but it's wrong, we go right at behavior. We start thinking, well, how am I going to get them to live better? You know, how am I going to get them to vote the way I vote? Or how am I going to get them to stop doing that? Because there's no way that they can enter into our kind of Christian bubble if they're going to practice this. That's going to have to change. And so we become paralyzed almost to the point where we're like, well, it would be better if I don't even get into a conversation. It would be better if I don't even build a relationship because there's going to be an awkward time at some point. There's going to be a point where they're going to say, you mean you really believe whatever it is? And you're like, well, actually, yes, I do. You know, and then what? Someone going to throw a plate? Is dinner over? Are we no longer grilling out back? What's going to happen? And so we worry about that. I think right here at the beginning of John's gospel, we have a picture of what we can do. We can bear witness to the light. We can talk about Jesus. Will those questions come up? They absolutely will. Will we have to deal with them? Yes. But if we are consistently doing what John the Baptist did, bear witness about the light. This is about Jesus. I will point you to him. I will point you to Christ. And as that relationship grows, then the conviction in your heart hopefully will grow, and then you will understand where your life needs to change. And as we come together and as we work through scripture together possibly, and you're like, well, what does this mean and that mean? You can be honest with one another and move in the direction of what it says. But we let Jesus do that. I mean, the first thing we do is pray for them. Somebody around you, you don't know how you're going to talk to them about Jesus, pray. And then start to bear witness about the light. Be like Christ in how you engage. And when you can, work Jesus into the discussion. Don't be crazy about it, right? Every discussion is not about Jesus. If they came over for pepper or they came over for sugar, maybe that's all they need. I'll give you some sugar, but let me give you something that will be even better for you. You know, they've got a cake to make, all right? But you can begin that conversation. And then can I point out an encouraging word here, all, that all might believe through him? It's as though both of the Johns, right, John the writer and John the Baptist, want us to understand that no one is beyond the light. No one is so caught up in darkness that Jesus cannot call them out of it. We're very good sometimes at looking and saying there is no hope for that person. There is no hope for this person. And yet, as this gospel unfolds, we see Jesus continually coming to people who have no hope. Continually coming to people who the world has written off and the world has set aside. And as people bear witness about the light, they are called out of their darkness. And this should be an encouragement to us, because I know that there are people here, and you feel as though your children, as they grow up, are walking headlong into the dark. You feel like that is where they are right now. And that may be where they are spiritually. They are in a darkness. They have put themselves there. Circumstances have drawn them there. Whatever it might be. But you feel like they are in some sort of spiritual darkness. And you wonder, will they ever come out? Jesus can pull them out of that darkness. Some of you, you have a friend. And it's someone who you've been talking to for years. You've been explaining what you believe. You've been talking about the gospel. You've read books so that you could better explain to them what it means to follow after Jesus. Yet you feel as though they are still groping in the spiritual darkness, despite the fact that you continually tell them where the light is. Jesus can call them out of that darkness. You see sometimes people that you respect and you believe a lot of what they believe. You find a lot in common. But when it gets to this, they seem to be, again, groping in the darkness. And you wonder, will they ever come out of it? Jesus can pull them out of it. And that should always be our prayer. And that should always be our hope. Because Jesus overcomes the darkness. He also calls us out of the darkness. But then finally, in this short passage, we see that Jesus exposes the darkness. As John kind of ties this short discussion together, he makes sure to identify Jesus as the true light. The true light. And remember, words are never wasted. That word true is so important, because the implication here is that other things will claim to be the light, or they'll try and fill a similar purpose in our life. It's likely that John is writing during a time where the religious and philosophical fad of the day was to acquire some kind of secret knowledge, some secret knowledge that would help you to understand how the world works. And you could get this secret knowledge only if it was shared to you in certain ceremonies or in a backroom kind of deal. And the knowledge then was the light. And if you had that light, then it would help you to understand how the world works and how your place goes in it. And sometimes people would take Christian principles and they would weave it into these other ideas about light and all sorts of things to create something that's really fairly confusing so that they could hold control over other people. The only way you can know about the light is if I tell you. But yet John here right at the beginning is like, listen, you don't need anything. You need to know this. Jesus is the light. Boom. Now read about it. Here it is. No one has to take you in a back room. No one has to explain this to you beyond what is here. No one has to tell you the secret knowledge. It's all written down. It's all right here. And so when John says that Jesus is the true light, he is calling every other thing that claims to be light false. He's looking at every other worldview. He's looking at every other spiritual system, every other answer to the big questions of the world and of life, and he's saying they're false. They will only get you so far. They will explain some things, but not everything. They might be good, but they're not ultimate. They might be clever, but they're not true. They may be creative, but they're not from the Creator. John, right off the bat, kind of is coming out swinging, saying everything else you think is going to get you there, everything else you think that will bring meaning, that you think will bring you out of the darkness, all of these other things, they're not real. It's going to lead you somewhere else, and it might feel brighter, but it's dark. So then you go somewhere else and it seems brighter, but after a little while it's dark. And the darkness continues and continues and continues. The only light, the true light, is Jesus. Whenever I would go camping or hunting or anywhere out in the wilderness with my father's always prepared for everything. And he always made it a point to have a light that would dwarf any light that anyone else would have. I remember as a child, he had one flashlight. He's like, never look right at this. I'm like, why do we even have that light if it's going to blind people? All right, but we had it. And I remember I would be out in the woods and I would have my little flashlight and I'm like, this is a great light. I can see whatever I need to see, right? I can see right in front of me. I know where I'm going. Play flashlight tag with this light. It'd be great. And then my dad, I think on purpose, would just shine his light where I was looking. All right, because he's competitive. Just to show me that what I think is helping, what I think is bright, is nothing compared to what he had. All right, John here is saying, listen, you're going to find, people have found purpose in things. People find happiness in things for a time. People find joy in things, and they think other things will bring light. And sometimes I would even say they light it up a bit. Because there's grace in all sorts of things. There's truth in a lot. All truth, though, belongs to God. And so sometimes we're huddled around this little light, thinking that it's going to bring light to the darkness. It's going to show us where we need to go. And we're ignoring the spotlight that's right there. And we think we can see our way, and we think we'll make it through without falling. With my dad on one of those camping trips, we played flashlight tag, and I was running in a field, as fast as I can with my little light. And I ran directly into a picnic table. And when I hit the picnic table, I hit it twice. I hit it first here and then there. All right? But I kept playing because that's what Copelands do. All right? But I remember my dad saying, if you had a better light, son, you wouldn't have hit that picnic table. I'm not so sure. All right? But the point being, sometimes we think we know where we're headed. We think we have an idea on this. But yet, what light are we following? All right, Jesus' light exposes the darkness. We're going to sing a song to close. And this is what I think. I think a lot of us, when we talk about darkness and we talk about the dark times of life, we think of something specific. John, as he's writing this, is specifically thinking about sin. He's specifically thinking about where our heart is at, the darkness of evil that draws us away and draws us towards death. That's what John is thinking about. But if we had John here, he would say, I believe, that there is darkness in our life. It manifests itself in many ways. For some of you here today, you are groping around in spiritual darkness. You felt like you had it figured out. You thought you knew what life meant. You thought you knew the direction to go, yet you would say, I'm looking for something, and I haven't found it yet. I would beg of you today, find someone who brought you here. Talk to Pastor Matt. Talk to myself. Help us explain better to you what it means that Jesus is a light and how that helps you to see and understand spiritual things in a better way. There are others of us here, and you would say, I know Jesus. I understand him. I have a relationship with him. It is what I'm trying to keep at the center of my life. But right now, in this moment, in this day, I feel like I'm in darkness. I feel like I have gotten away from that. I feel like I have moved away from that in my life for some reason, whether it's circumstances or your own choices, and you do not feel like you are in that light today. Then I would beg of you to come back. And I would say also, find someone who can pray with you, someone who can hold you accountable, someone who can point you in that direction. And then there are some of us who would say, you know what, I feel like I'm in the light. I mean, I feel like the vitamin D is just right on me. I feel great. You need to be praying for others. You need to be pulling others in. You need to be like John the Baptist and bear witness about that light. All right, we all have a place in this, and we all have a part in this. As John's gospel unfolds, we'll see places where we're like, that was my life. This is how I feel today. This is where I'm at. So when we see that, we dive into that. Not so that we can point to ourselves, not so that we can tell other people, do as I have done, but so that we can be like John the Baptist and not bear witness about ourselves, but bear witness about the light. Let's stand as we sing.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree.
His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, the side of
chorus again.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
Will you pray with me? Father, we know that there are many things in this world that claim to point us in the direction that we should go, that claim to give us the knowledge that we need so that our life will be purposeful, that our life will be productive, that our life will be joy-filled. Yet, Father, what we're trusting in here today is what your word says, that your Son, that our Savior, he is the true light. I pray that we would live our lives as though this is true, that we would live our lives with this truth in mind, that we would, through what we say and do, bear witness to the light, that we would point others to Jesus, knowing that he has overcome the darkness and that he has brought us with him. We're grateful for that. And I pray that in everything we do, others will see that you will be honored and that you will be glorified. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.